Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hope, from the Heart of Horses, How Horses Teach Us About Presence, Strength, and Awareness, by Kathy Pike. Foreword by Linda Kohanov. Narrated by Anne-Marie Lee. Foreword. The vast majority of centaurs were a rowdy, drunken bunch, until Chiron came along. Resisting the body temptations associated with his kind, the legendary man-horse tapped the ingredients of true genius, creating a maverick fusion of humanity and nature, intellect and intuition, strength and vulnerability, passion and reason, all trotting around in one graceful, fleet-footed, four-legged body. Perhaps more important, Chiron's dynamic myth revealed a template for healing that transmuted difficulties into gifts and traumas into sources of power. A celebrated teacher of heroes, Jason and Achilles among them, he not only strengthened his students' bodies and sharpened their minds, he instructed them in the soulful art of discovering their destiny. Yet Chiron's own path was altered by a seemingly senseless accident. During archery practice, he was mistakenly shot in the knee with a poison arrow. Delirious and limping in agony, he retreated into an underground cave to repair a potentially fatal wound. In trying different remedies, the centaur created the healing arts and went on to teach these skills to Asclepius, the Greek god of medicine. Thereafter, Chiron became known as the Wounded Healer. Few people have lived the trajectory of Chiron's myth as closely as Kathy Pike. Fewer still are lucid enough to write about this transformational journey with such honesty, insight, and skill. Yet the multidisciplinary genius needed to create a book of this quality was the prize she received at the end of a sometimes painful, ultimately inspiring series of events that essentially turned her into a centaur. Inside Kathy's heart beats the soul of a four-legged woman, and a succession of living, breathing horses helped her access that secret power. Early entanglements with drugs and a later serious riding accident set Kathy on a path of self-healing. Along the way, she developed the courage and fortitude to share her hard-won wisdom with others. As an author, lecturer, coach, entrepreneur, and most recently, as an innovative clinician in the fast-growing field of equine-facilitated human development, where horses teach people valuable life skills. Like Chiron, her holistic approach to education and healing blossomed into the urge to help others discover their destiny. Her unique style of coaching empowers people by exercising that same seemingly paradoxical combination of qualities that have brought her increasing success in her own life. Spend any significant time with Kathy, and you'll encounter a strong-willed, tenacious, refreshingly honest person who can also be tender, thoughtful, compassionate, and vulnerable. In short, she has learned to balance head and heart, logic and intuition, ambition and reflection in the truest tradition of the mythical centaur himself. As Kathy became ever sounder of body, mind, and spirit, she accessed the resources to move beyond the riding trauma that robbed her of one of her greatest loves a decade earlier. Then, and only then, did horses come back into her life. This book is the story of what it took to reconnect with a species that fully embodies what Kathy is now eminently qualified to teach. With help from a series of equine guides, Kathy brought the most profound aspect of the Chiron myth to fruition in her own life. She became a wounded healer, capable of teaching other potential heroes how to follow their own destiny, tapping the creativity, vitality, and courage needed to wrestle the hidden gifts from life's many difficulties. I'm honored to be one of those two-legged creatures who have shared her journey at times, witnessing the profound ways that horses changed her life, the ways that she returned the favor, and the innovative partnerships she now forms with these regal creatures to initiate other lucky humans in the centaurian arts. And I'm thrilled to recommend this book as one of the finest narratives on what horses have to teach people about life, love, power, and connection as we release them from their roles of beasts of burden and allow them to reclaim their true destiny as teachers, healers, and companions worthy of the deepest affection and respect. Linda Kohanov, author of The Tao of Equus, Riding Between the Worlds, and Way of the Horse. Introduction. In writing Hope, I was fueled by my desire to help people understand how horses heal, empower, and enhance the lives of humans. I also wanted Hope to inspire compassion for horses and all living creatures. Lama Surya Das said, "Our lack of compassion stems from our inability to see deeply into the nature of things." When I returned to work with horses after an accident in my 20s, I shifted my perspective from what I wanted horses to do for me and began to see what horses were offering to me. I needed to see the nature of horses instead of asking them to fit into my world. Thus, my real journey with horses began. Hope offers stories about how horses touch and alter people's lives. Horses are now recognized for their capacity to transport individuals both spiritually and emotionally to higher levels of awareness. Equine-based learning programs and handicapped riding centers are being established all over the country. The rise in popularity of books focused on the relationship humans have with horses and even dogs and cats offers promise that animals are now being seen as sentient beings. My natural inclination as a life coach is to inspire and lift individuals to embody what is possible for them and to ignite their courage to bring their gift into the world. Horses are my partners in teaching and coaching others to achieve this goal. As Antoine de Saint-Exupéry said, "If you want to build a ship, don't herd people together to collect wood and don't assign them tasks and work, but rather teach them to long for the endless immensity of the sea." Watch the exuberance of a herd of horses sprinting boldly through a field, and you will connect with the energy that lies within you and is waiting to be ignited with your passion. The unleashed power and complete physical freedom exhibited by horses inspire people to find their own inner freedom and uncensored expression of self that is analogous to the endless immensity of the sea. I seldom suggest that clients collect wood or assign them tasks and work. Instead, I strive to teach them to see the world through a horse's eyes and learn the horse's way. Through this experience, their longing is awakened. Then the tasks to build an authentic life, the pieces that bring their life calling to realization, or the ship, flow with clarity and enthusiasm. A desire for connection to self, nature, and others fills the heart when one sees horses grazing in harmony. Horses' need for social structure and their non-judgmental approach to relationships ignite potential from the human heart to be touched, opened, and altered. There are no coincidences in what one experiences with a horse, be it harmony, rebellion, cooperation, union, or disconnection. Everything has meaning. The interactions we have with horses directly reflect how we approach our human-to-human world. Horses are the mirrors to our soul. Watch an upper-level rider in any discipline, and you will find deep connection and understanding between horse and rider. Achieving union and feel while balancing leadership can be a complex task. Horses are sensitive animals that easily understand and assimilate the whole being approach to relationship. Hope shares stories of how riders blend and integrate such aspects of the mind, body, and spirit to create higher levels of harmony and an invisible connection with their horses. Horses need, want, and demand to know the leader in all of their relationships. A horse asks, "Who shall lead, you or I?" Quick to read body language, emotional messages, and verbal communications, horses give you exactly what you ask and respond in the manner that you have asked. Individuals in positions of influence learn to refine their leadership skills through learning the way of the horse. The book's title came from a horse named Hope that you will hear about in Chapter 3. Hope, in its purest form, is not simply being optimistic or wishing well. Hope is a spiritual experience that is uplifting and compels a person forward, creating momentum toward improving a situation. Hope acknowledges that the human perspective is limited. That which is current is not the full potential of what is possible. It recognizes that things can be and will be better in the unknown and unseen future, and that goodness prevails. Everything in my life transpires from continual waves of hope that move through me and propel me forward during tough times. I innately know that there are higher levels of unconditional love and compassion to learn, and that it is animals, and especially horses, that are my greatest teachers. Their hearts, which are 5 times larger than the human heart, support me unconditionally and give me strength. Horses continue to teach me deeper levels of self-awareness, trust in myself, and heart-based leadership. They challenge me to look at my greatest fears and lift my spirit to greater levels of joy. After you finish this book, I hope that you see and experience all animals as sentient beings and teachers for humans. I hope the horses and people in the stories shared in Hope touch your heart and intrigue you to create a deeper relationship with a horse and all animals. May you have the fortune to experience hope from the heart of a horse. In Riding a Horse, We Borrow Freedom. Helen Thompson. Dragged. Plastic horses in dusty dirt, invisible lines for fences. I would make my horses travel far, from one imaginary ranch to the next, jumping boulders, crossing streams, guided by my hand on their backs, as my knees pressed into the ground, stone impressions leaving bumps and ridges in my young skin. Endless hours and timeless days spent in the dreamtime of horses, a wild cowgirl in the West. I played it all out in the backyard sandbox in a small town in the state of Maine. By day, my herd would work and play. At night, they would sleep next to my bed. Years passed, and I grew from age 7 to 27, when my games in the sandbox became fond memories. I had made it to the West and was just beginning to reach for my dream of horses. Seeking my childhood fantasies, I had saved my money to take my first set of riding lessons. Finally, my dream was becoming a reality. 2 weeks of lessons with a young, energetic horse had hooked me. My joy was interrupted when I went away for a 2-week holiday in Maine to enjoy the cool, moist coastal air. I could not wait to return to my new 4-legged friend. Back from my trip, on a fine August day, I headed to the barn in the mountains of Utah. On this day, I was unlucky and lucky both at the same time. It was a thrill to be back in the saddle. After 2 weeks away, the smell of horses felt like home, the home of my heart. This was the day I was to learn to canter. The sun warmed the fine, buttery, smooth leather of the English saddle. My horse was a gorgeous 5-year-old 16-hand Tricaner Warmblood. He was big, young, dark, and stunning. No one had ridden him while I was away. My instructor told me he might be a bit spunkier than usual, something about not having been ridden and his diet having more energy-rich alfalfa than usual. At the time, her words meant nothing to me. A 4-second segment of this lesson would become a pivotal point in my life. As often as I think time flies, at times it slows down, stands still, and elongates as senses become heightened, alive, and fully engaged in the moment. These moments become memories. In the future, they emerge easily in full detail. At times, these memories enhance our life, and at other times, they stunt our growth and block potential. Memories are significant moments that shape lives and define the character of a person. It is easy for me to remember aspects of that lesson on the glorious, sleek, and shiny Tricaner. One moment, the soft leather saddle absorbed my legs and seat. The next, I was bouncing on the hard, hot ground. Hooves pounded the dirt a few feet from my eyes. My foot was stuck in the stirrup. My head banged on the ground. My body yanked and tugged relentlessly as the horse dragged me, stretching every joint in my body. To this day, 20 years later, I can still see those hooves so clearly. Their multicolored tan, sparked with silver shoes, dusty from the ground they pounded, inches from my face, my head, my arms, my chest. I remember choking on the dust, being flayed by the sprays of dirt, the commotion, the screeching horse, and my instructor yelling. I remember those few seconds passing in slow motion. Those 4 seconds felt like long minutes. My life slowed while the horse unleashed a frenzy of power, throwing me on the ground and then dragging me by his side. My head, safely tucked away inside my helmet, slammed against the ground. Suddenly, I heard a voice speak in my mind. My voice. What did she tell me to do if I ever got dragged? Another voice, clear and direct, replied, her voice, roll on your belly. I rolled over. Once I was on my belly, my foot instantly slid out of the stirrup. Everything came to a stop. Splayed face down in the dirt, my body was limp and still. At first, I was not sure I wanted to move or that I could. What just happened? Where was I? After stopping the horse, my instructor ran to my aid. Bending over me, she asked, "Can you move? Is anything broken?" Her voice lingered, skirting on the edges of my consciousness, seeming far away, even though she was kneeling next to me. Slowly, I rose, first to my knees, then to a crouch, then, with her help, slowly to my feet. My body shook, and everything hurt like hell. I might have hurt less in a show or training arena filled with soft, sandy footing. This area was only a fenced sagebrush field with a slight slope naturally worn down by hours of horses and riders walking, trotting, cantering, and pounding the earth flat and unforgiving. Sporting injuries were not uncommon to me. Days spent mountain biking, rock climbing, river running, and backcountry skiing had not all passed without accidents and close calls. My life revolved around the adventure of exploring the wild of nature. Near misses, chance accidents, falls and tumbles, too many to count. But not one had felt like this. An excited, rapid stream of apologies came from my instructor's mouth. She repeatedly told me her horse did not mean to do what he did. She told me that I needed to realize this, and I needed to pet him and reassure him. This was the last thing on my mind. It was all I could do to glance at this horse. I could not speak. My mind screamed, "What about me? The hell with the horse. I don't care about the damn horse. I am freaked out. I'm in pain and my body hurts." Once assured that I had no broken bones, my instructor shifted her attention to her young horse. He stood against the fence, as far away from us as possible, head low and eyes worried. She immediately moved to him and began to console him. Tender words and strokes to his neck kept him still and quiet. Removing the saddle that hung beneath the horse's belly, she undid the remaining buckles, clearly disappointed that the leather had been ripped and her saddle destroyed. It was her best saddle. She fetched another from the tack room nearby and then announced, "You will get back on the horse. If not," she told me, "I would always be afraid of riding." I stood immobilized, traumatized, and partially dissociated. I refused. There was no way I was going to get back on the horse. The instructor tried in every way she knew to convince me how important it was that we, the horse and I, move past the episode and end with a good experience. Again, I refused. Every single cell in my body screamed, "No way! Danger, death, pain, that horse will kill me!" I simply wanted out. I wanted out of the arena, away from her, and away from that horse. 10 weeks of companionship were voided, nullified, and non-existent. Recognizing my resolve, my instructor shifted gears. If I refused to get on the horse that threw me, then I would have to get on another horse that had watched the whole mishap. She fetched her older Appaloosa and saddled him up. I dreaded getting on the Appaloosa, but I folded. I had no energy to argue and thought the quickest way to get away was to do what she wanted. As I walked, sparks of pain shot through my joints. Stiffness was already setting in. I felt every part of my body, and every part of it was in pain. I could not tell whether any one area was more painful than another. Everything ached, as if I had been trampled as well as dragged. She helped me climb into the saddle and onto the white horse with reddish-brown spots. This older, usually docile horse swished his tail. It was probably a fly, but it mattered not to me. My mind went wild with fear, anticipating another thrashing. There I sat for no more than 2 seconds, 2 very long seconds. Tears wanted release. Unable to allow them to fall, instead I wore tight, pinched lips and a frozen face. My instructor asked me to begin to walk the horse. I refused. I climbed off, declared that was good enough, and walked to the small dark old shed that was used as a tack room. Hands still slightly shaking, I hung the helmet, walked off the property, and never went back. My instructor stood with her horses, watching me leave. It was the end of the beginning of my budding career with horses. Ironically, just weeks earlier, I had expressed an interest in competing. The next 2 days, my tender body lay flat in bed, the scrapes and cuts sticking to the sheets. I could not find any comfortable position. My joints felt stretched and bruised. Moving required me to tune out of my body, hold my breath, and swallow back any gasps, as they would only trigger more pain. I had no health insurance, so a visit to the doctor was out of the question. I figured my body was healthy and it would heal in time. I was lucky. I remember how I had begged my instructor to let me ride without a helmet. She refused. I survived. There is no doubt in my mind that I would not be alive today if I had not worn that helmet. For this, I am grateful to her. How did my accident happen? Had we buckled the horse's saddle wrong? Had something been poking into his belly? Was he simply feeling young and hot after 2 weeks in the pasture? Was there something about me that made my horse simply want me off his back? There could be many other reasons and/or explanations. What was the horse's name? What was the instructor's name? To this day, I cannot remember either. However, I remember the instant we moved into the freedom of the canter. I remember the horse's power moving through my body, the wildness, the rhythm, and the enormity of it. I remember that immediately following that connection came the disconnection, the flight of my body in air, and the thud when it hit the ground. But most of all, I remember the hooves next to my face, sharp, vivid, and slashing, and the way everything moved in slow motion. A memory locked into my body, trauma and fear packed into my subconsciousness. When I left the barn, I left my dream of horses and part of myself behind. It took 12 years before I returned to horses. But when I walked away from the barn that sunny afternoon, I did not leave everything behind. I tried, but I failed. My body would not let me forget everything. It held the memory of the ecstatic joy of that first canter, the taste of freedom followed by being thrown and dragged. Letting go into a powerful flow had resulted in a hard jolt and slam. Would it ever be safe to let go into my joy again? Could I trust life? Could I ever feel that level of power and freedom and feel safe at the same time? For years, it was not possible. Instead, I became the victim, always waiting for something bad to happen, most often during something that was joyful. I could never fully embrace the sense of feeling safe in my body, safe in the world, and safe to be me, to be who I am. Fear lived just below my skin, haunting my potential and restricting my possibilities. I had no awareness of this, no consciousness of the effects of that accident, nor that the gift of it would emerge years later in my life. No one escapes trauma. No one gets to live life without it. Those who tell you that they have had a normal, uneventful life are kidding themselves, masking the incidents that have most shaped their consciousness. Trauma, small or big, is significant. It shapes beliefs and perceptions and controls a person's ability to live a fully empowered and healthy existence. The human body holds the memory of trauma even when our conscious mind does not. Sometimes we can access those memories, as in my situation. Other times, the body dissociates from the experience as a means to survive. Our coping mechanism decides that if death is near, it might be best not to be present in the body. Therefore, no pain can be felt. The body, censoring the mind, is actually a wondrous coping power. The conscious brain has no say in the matter. It is simply about surviving on the most basic primal level of existence. Our conscious mind can make decisions about how we can undo such traumas, rising above them and becoming more empowered and evolved through that experience. Undoing the trauma of this accident was a beneficial experience for me. What once was something I wanted to forget became my path to self-realization, my path back to myself, and ultimately the gateway to the very exciting and rewarding work I would do with others. The moment of trauma, the memory of it, was a defining moment in my life, one that would take work to undo and redo, but on the other side of the work was a joyous reuniting with myself, my whole self, a self that had more richness and complexity to offer than if I hadn't had the courage to do the work required to get there. Now, 20 years later, I am a life coach. I work with individuals to help them realize and actualize their deepest dreams and the purpose of their lives. When I am coaching my clients to higher levels of consciousness, to realizing that path they were born to live and stepping into their authenticity, I often invite them to look at the most difficult and most joyous times in their lives. They remember and look at the moments of trauma, the periods of darkness, and the times they would rather ignore and keep hidden in the dark. They remember the times of bliss and joy, the moments and days that were the best of their lives. These moments, the good and the difficult, shape these persons and give them the clues to their gifts, leading them back to their true selves. Every incident in life gives us the opportunity for growth, for exploring our awareness, and for reshaping our perception of the world. These most difficult times provide the greatest moments of definition once we are willing to look at them, heal them, and reclaim a part of ourselves that we might have given up. Reclaiming the joyous times ignites the energy that makes us feel whole and alive. After the accident, I willed my childhood obsession and fantasies to die. There was no desire to heal this event in my life. Horses no longer existed for me. I blocked their existence from my life. I doubted the force, the desire that had been neatly tucked away, pressing against the surface all of my life. Allowing myself to have what I wanted, what gave me joy, resulted in danger, injury, and getting slammed into the ground with 1,200 pounds of muscle, sinew, heart, breath, and power poised over my physical and emotional body. The walls of protection rose and formed around me. Thankfully for me, the horses would not allow me to keep hiding. My past wounds would not go without healing. It was 12 long years before I allowed horses to come into my consciousness again. Slowly they began to appear, tugging on my heartstrings, stirring my fears, tempting me as I moved with great trepidation. I did not seek horses out. Rather, they found me. The love for a horse is just as complicated as the love for another human being. If you never love a horse, you will never understand. Unknown. Polo Ponies. A few years after being dragged by that horse in search of a more meaningful life, I chose to leave Park City. I was jaded by the decadence of living in a resort community, and it was time to move on and find something else. The recreational drinking, the drugs, and the uncommitted lifestyle, a lifestyle that lacked any sense of responsibility to oneself or to others, no longer appealed to me. After 12 years of living there, it was hard to move out of my patterns with the friends I had. Our habits, our routines, and the things we always did together no longer fulfilled me. It was time to break away, to change my life, and reinvent myself. Boulder, Colorado was a strong draw because it offered an alternative community. Having just become a massage therapist, I found a nice niche doing body work in a chiropractor's office. I loved contributing to others' well-being in this way. My work was enhanced by my studies in polarity therapy and manual lymph drainage technique, and through developing my own yoga, meditation, and personal growth practices. Significant changes in my life began to emerge naturally. I shifted from an outdoor adventure and party-oriented identity to a spiritual path, cleaning up my diet and my habits. Taking a hard look at my life, my relationship to myself, and what I wanted for my future became a primary focus for growth. Knowing that my life would continue to be based on being of service to others, I searched for another outlet for these desires. In addition to body work, my interests flowed into the area of helping others improve their lives through increasing their self-awareness and recognizing their passions and gifts. A fairly new profession called life coaching caught my attention, and my life shifted from adventure and exploration to learning more and helping others. It was fall, and I had landed a job as a caretaker on a property just outside of Boulder that included a herd of 4 polo ponies. The owner seemed nice and fair. His Argentine polo ponies were small, around 15 hands each, but strong, with a bit of wildness in them. They were young and had been in the United States a short period of time. Polo season had just ended, and they would be out to pasture for the winter. It would be my job to feed them and keep an eye on them. It did not completely register in my mind that I would be taking care of the ponies. My accident had drifted into my past, becoming something I need not face again. The caretaker's job landed me on 20 beautiful acres, just enough room for a few horses, a sense of space, and the peacefulness of the countryside. Newly built, the main house had yellow siding and a wraparound white porch. It was modest, yet had style. The position included living quarters above the garage. It was perfect. It was clean and quiet, and the work exchange worked well for me. The herd consisted of 2 black horses, 1 sorrel, and a bay. All were mares, all the same size, and it took me a good month to tell them apart and to remember their Spanish names. Mulatona, Argentina, Sebastian, and Junta. My job was to throw hay to them morning and night and to make sure their water trough was full. One of these ponies, Junta, was feisty and aggressive, always at the front of the pack, ready for her food. She was the one I trusted least. She had a way of looking at me with her head held high that felt defiant and confrontational. My apartment above the garage gave me a bird's eye view of the herd. I watched them during the day as I worked from my desk. It gave me great joy to see them so close, but my fears still ran me. All winter long, I danced around them, negotiating my place among them. On the cold nights, when I fed after dark, I would cross the pasture to reach the barn where the hay was stored. Part of me loved these nights, not just because it was cold and dark. I enjoyed the elements and relished the star-covered sky, still free of the well-lit streets and malls of the surrounding towns. I would choose to go out without a light as my eyes became accustomed to the dark nights. However, a bit of tension would fill my body until I crossed the pasture and finished feeding the horses. Only then could I enjoy the night. It was easy to feel and sense where the herd was resting as I ducked under the wood rails of the fence, and they would be aware as soon as I had crossed from my turf to theirs. The soft rustling of their movements rang familiar in my ears, 1, 2, and then 3 of them beginning to walk. Then there would be 4, eager for their meal, moving now from a walk to a trot, footfalls getting lighter, legs lifting higher. I would feel and hear their collective energy build. Then the hooves would shift from a pleasant and light trot to a determined movement, a thundering stampede on the frozen ground. The earth would tremble like a freight train screeching through town. As the sound of their storming hooves grew louder, I would break into my own version of a 2-legged gallop, fearful that if I did not outpace them, they would trample me. Could they see in the dark? And if they could, would they care enough to go around me? I ducked under the electric fence in the nick of time. Panting with fear, I gulped the dry mountain air as the cold burned the inside of my nose. The hungry herd stopped on a dime, inches from the fence, their nostrils flared, shooting hot steam into the freezing night. They danced in front of me with their heads held high. Standing and staring back at them, I took refuge in knowing that just a thin line of electricity was between us. I relaxed a little at the sound of the electric current buzzing in the wire, threatening to zap their hides. I knew it was enough to keep me safe. Sometimes I would laugh, even lecture the horses about being a bit more polite around feeding time. Other times I was angry when I barely made it under the fence or my mixed-breed dog, my comfort and constant companion, Suki, would get too close to the herd. When successful with my run, tuck, and duck, I would sometimes gloat in the power I held as the keeper of the food. Clearly, it was my own method of self-protection and defense as my heart pounded with fear around this powerful force of nature. I played this game with them during the first few months. The ponies were being ponies, and I, a fearful woman, wanted to connect with them but was too frightened to do so. As time passed, there were more nights that I would stand with the horses as they mellowed out with their meal. Their heads lowered to their hay piles on the ground, and I stood close by and watched, listening as they crunched and tossed hay. As they continuously searched the silence around us for potential threats, I followed the movements of their swiveling ears, which scanned for any signs of danger. Usually I would hear Suki hunting in the snowpack, chasing rodents and squirrels, and occasionally picking up the scent of a coyote. She was my canine friend and full of life. A mix of shepherd, collie, and healer, nothing got past her awareness. She was a hunter and runner. When she wasn't chasing her frisbee, she chased the wind, biting at leaves in the air and running down small creatures in the fields. There seemed to be no way to stop this primal instinctive behavior. She was relentlessly full of energy, yet as tender with children as a new mother. Highly sensitive and alert, she was at my side 24/7. During those nights with the horses, the peace would become a frenzy of barking, Suki hot in pursuit of a wild playmate. The night was as alive as the day, especially when the moon rose to fullness. Staring at the ponies, I knew that if I were to make it through this caretaking job, I would have to stop playing games and start dealing with my fear. The ranch owner offered a few suggestions on how to feel safe and set my boundaries with the hungry ponies. When around them, I learned how to maintain my personal space by making my presence bigger and releasing thoughts and fears that they wanted to trample me. The small tack room in the barn had a few training whips. I chose the small one, just 3 feet long. I used the whip to gain a little authority. Simply holding it made me feel a bit better. I knew I could use it if I needed to, though in my heart I had no intention of ever striking any of the ponies. That was not the purpose of the whip. Instead, the whip extended the length of my arm. Suddenly, I was bigger. When I extended my arm outward from my waist and gently swirled the whip, I instantly felt like I had more space around me. The horses, being sensitive to movement and energy, would respond right away if I gave a swish in front of me or by my side. They would either stop and maintain the length of the distance where the whip had swished, or they would back off slightly, respecting the distance defined by the whip. Watching the horses closely, I began to learn their herd dynamics and to see how they communicated with each other. If one approached another that did not want to be bothered, she might swish her tail as a warning, saying, "I see you. Keep your distance." If the first horse ignored the warning, the other would pin her ears. Her body began to tense, communicating a little louder, "I don't like your behavior." If the intruder continued to ignore these signs, the aggravated horse might snake her head out as a warning. If necessary, she would whip it again with more speed and intention, her action promising a bite. There would always be a progression of messages, each one more defined and intentional. One simply needed to pay attention to them and heed the warning. At mealtime, the more dominant horses lowered their heads and moved toward another mare already in the hay. The eating horse, yielding power, stepped out of the pile to find a new place to eat. Dominance was established. Having lived together, the four all knew where they belonged in the group. Mealtime was a time to be reminded. As I watched the polo ponies, I became curious about herd dynamics. It made me wonder whether when a herd became more stable or spent more time together without the interruption of new members, each member became more accepting of their rank in the herd. It was clear where I belonged in the pecking order. I was the new girl, and I found myself at the bottom of the order, the least respected. I was going to have to focus on being physically safe until I had them figured out. Then, and only then, would I learn and apply ways to creep ahead and earn respect. Little knowledge and a big ego would only get me hurt.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.